If you want to turn words into numbers, and you want those numbers to make sense, then use word embeddings, and similar words will have similar numbers. Hooray, StatQuest. Hello, I'm Josh Starmer, and welcome to StatQuest. Today we're going to talk about word embedding and Word2Vec, and they're going to be clearly explained. Lightning makes using the cloud just as easy to use as your laptop, and that's cool. This StatQuest is also brought to you by the letters A, B, and C. A, always. B, B. C, curious. Always be curious. Also, I want to give a special thanks to Alex Lavahi and the students at Boston University's Spark for letting me test this StatQuest out on them. Note, this StatQuest is focused on how neural networks can be used to create word embeddings and assumes that you are already familiar with the basic ideas of neural networks and backpropagation, as well as the main ideas about the softmax function and cross-entropy. If not, check out the quests. Words are great. We can use them to communicate all kinds of cool ideas. For example,
"Hey Norm, isn't StatQuest awesome?"
"It sure is, Squatch."
Unfortunately, a lot of machine learning algorithms, including neural networks, don't work well with words.
"Hey neural network, isn't StatQuest awesome?"
So, if we want to plug words into a neural network or some other machine learning algorithm, we need a way to turn the words into numbers.
24, 0.3, 5.1.
Yes, StatQuest is awesome.
Bam!
One super easy way to convert words into numbers is to just assign each word to a random number. For example, if someone just saw the hit movie Troll 2 and said, "Troll 2 is great," we can just give each word a random number. Note, for the purposes of this StatQuest, we're going to treat Troll 2 as a single word. Anyway, if the next person said, "Troll 2 is awesome," then we could reuse the random numbers that we already selected for Troll 2 and is, and assign a new random number to the new word, awesome. In theory, this is fine. But it means that even though great and awesome mean similar things and are used in similar ways, they have very different numbers associated with them, 4.2 and negative 32.1. And that means the neural network will probably need a lot more complexity and training, because learning how to correctly process the word great won't help the neural network correctly use the word awesome. So it would be nice if similar words that are used in similar ways could be given similar numbers, so that learning how to use one word will help learn how to use the other at the same time. And because the same words can be used in different contexts, or made plural, or used in some other way, it might be nice to assign each word more than one number so that the neural network can more easily adjust to different contexts. For example, the word great can be used in a positive way, like, "StatQuest is great!" And it can also be used in a sarcastic, negative way, like, "My cell phone's broken. Great." And it would be nice if we had one number that could keep track of the positive ways that great is used, and a different number to keep track of the negative ways.
"Hey Josh, deciding what words are similar and used in similar contexts sounds like a lot of work. And using more than one number per word to account for different contexts sounds like even more work."
Don't worry, Squatch. The good news is that we can get a super simple neural network to do all of the work for us.
Bam!
To show how we can get a super simple neural network to figure out what numbers should go with different words, let's imagine we have two phrases, "Troll 2 is great" and "Jim Cotta is great." Anyway, both phrases have two words, "Troll 2 and Jim Cotta," in similar contexts, because someone, and I'm not going to name names, thinks that these two terrible movies are great. So, in order to create a neural network to figure out what numbers we should associate with each word, the first thing we do is create inputs for each unique word. In this case, we have four unique words in the training data, so we have four inputs. Now we connect each input to at least one activation function. Note, this activation function uses the identity function. And thus, the input value is the same as the output value. In other words, this activation function doesn't do anything except give us a place to do addition. The number of activation functions corresponds to how many numbers we want to associate with each word. And the weights on those connections will, ultimately, be the numbers that we associate with each word. Now, in this example, we want to associate two numbers with each word. So that means we'll use two activation functions. And the weights on the connection to the second activation function will be another number associated with each word. However, like always, these weights start out with random values that we'll optimize with backpropagation. Now, in order to do backpropagation, we have to make predictions. So we'll use the input word to predict the next word in the phrase. So, if the phrase is, Troll 2 is great, then we can use the word Troll 2 to predict the word is. In other words, if the input word is Troll 2, and we indicate that by putting a 1 into the Troll 2 input and zeros into all of the other inputs, then we want the output for the next word, is, to have the largest value. And if the input word is, which means that the input for is 1 and all of the other inputs are 0, then we want the output for the next word, great, to have the largest value. Lastly, if the input word is gymkata, which means that the input for gymkata is 1 and all of the other inputs are 0, then we want the output for the next word, is, to have the largest value. In order to make these predictions, we connect the activation functions to outputs, and we add weights to those connections with random initialization values. And then we run the outputs through the softmax function because we have multiple outputs for classification. And that means we can use the cross-entropy loss function for backpropagation. Again, the goal is to train this neural network so that it correctly predicts the next word in a phrase. And now, before training, if we plug the word troll2 into the input and do the math, we get lucky and correctly predict the next word, is, but just barely. However, when we plug the word is into the input and do the math, then we fail to correctly predict the next word, great, and instead predict is. Wah wah. So we need to train this neural network. However, before we optimize all of the weights, remember that I said that these weights would be the numbers associated with each word. And since, in this example, we have two weights for each word, we can plot each word on a graph that has the weight values to the top activation function on the x-axis and the weight values to the bottom activation function on the y-axis. For example, the word troll2 goes here because its top weight is 0.38 and its bottom weight is 0.42. Likewise, the word is goes here and the word great goes here. And gymkata goes here. Now, with this graph, we see that the words troll2 and gymkata are currently no more similar to each other as they are to any of the other words. However, because both words appear in the same context in the training data, we hope that backpropagation will make their weights more similar. So we start with these weights, and we end up with these new weights. The new weights on the connections from the inputs to the activation functions are the word embeddings. And when we plot the words using the new weights, which are now the embeddings, we see that troll2 and gymkata are now relatively close to each other compared to the other words in the training data. Bam! Now that we've trained the neural network, we can see how well it predicts the next word. For example, if we plug the word troll2 into the input and do the math, then the output for the next word is 1 and everything else is 0. And that is exactly what we wanted. And when we plug the word is into the input and do the math, then the output for the next word in both phrases, great, is 1 and everything else is 0. Lastly, when we plug the word gymkata into the input and do the math, then the output for the next word is 1 and everything else is 0. Bam! Now, before we talk about a popular word embedding tool, Word2Vec, let's summarize what we've learned so far. First, rather than just assign random numbers to words, we can train a relatively simple neural network to assign numbers for us. The advantage of using a neural network is that it can use the context of words in the training dataset to optimize weights that can be used for the embeddings. And this can result in similar words ending up with similar embeddings. Lastly, having similar words with similar embeddings means training a neural network to process language is easier, because learning how one word is used helps learn how similar words are used. Double bam! Now, so far, we've shown we can train a neural network to predict the next word in each phrase. But just predicting the next word doesn't give us a lot of context to understand each one. So, now let's learn about the two strategies that Word2Vec, a popular method for creating word embeddings, uses to include more context. The first method, called continuous bag of words, increases the context by using the surrounding words to predict what occurs in the middle. For example, the continuous bag of words method could use the words troll2 and great to predict the word that occurs between them, is. The second method, called skipgram, increases the context by using the word in the middle to predict the surrounding words. For example, the skipgram method could use the word is to predict the surrounding words troll2, great, and gymkata. Lastly, before we're done, just know that in practice, instead of using just two activation functions to create two embeddings per word, people often use 100 or more activation functions to create a lot of embeddings per word. And instead of using two sentences for training, they use the entire Wikipedia. Thus, instead of just having a vocabulary of 4 words and phrases, Word2Vec might have a vocabulary of about 3 million words and phrases. Thus, the total number of weights in this neural network that we need to optimize is 3 million words and phrases times at least 100, the number of weights each word has going to the activation functions, times 2 for the weights that get us from the activation functions to the outputs, for a total of 600 million weights. So training can be slow. However, one way that Word2Vec speeds things up is to use something called negative sampling. Negative sampling works by randomly selecting a subset of words we don't want to predict for optimization. For example, say like we wanted the word aardvark to predict the word A. That means that only the word aardvark has a 1 in it, and all of the other words have zeros. And that means we can ignore the weights coming from every word but aardvark, because the other words multiply their weights by 0. That alone removes close to 300 million weights from this optimization step. However, we still have 300 million weights after the activation functions. So, because we want to predict the word A, then we don't want to predict aardvark, abandon, and all of the other words. So, for this example, let's imagine Word2Vec randomly selects abandon as a word we don't want to predict. Note, in practice, Word2Vec would select between 2 and 20 words that we don't want to predict. However, in this example, we just select 1, abandon. So now, Word2Vec only uses the output values for A and abandon. And that means, for this round of backpropagation, we can ignore the weights that lead to all of the other possible outputs. So, in the end, out of the 600 million total weights in this neural network, we only optimize 300 per step. And this is one way that Word2Vec can efficiently create lots of word embeddings for each word in a large vocabulary. Triple bam! Now it's time for some shameless self-promotion. If you want to review statistics and machine learning offline, check out the StatQuest PDF study guides and my book, The StatQuest Illustrated Guide to Machine Learning, at statquest.org. There's something for everyone. Hooray! We've made it to the end of another exciting StatQuest. If you like this StatQuest and want to see more, please subscribe. And if you want to support StatQuest, consider contributing to my Patreon campaign, becoming a channel member, buying one or two of my original songs or a t-shirt or a hoodie, or just donate. The links are in the description below. All right, until next time, quest on!